There's how my trip began. Looks like his when it ended, huh? That was my first view of Moldova as I was coming into the country. And again, King Stefan, right? Stefan, King Stephen the Great. So, you know, he's kind of the founder of Moldova. And so they look up to him. This was the national church, as he mentioned. 93% of the people there are Orthodox. You've heard of Greek Orthodox and Russian Orthodox, and it's a member of that family. And so this was the national church. We went in there. Dumb American, I took about 3 pictures before somebody pointed at the wall. There was clearly a camera there with a red slash through it. It's like, I can't believe I really did this. But anyway, so there was the national church. We went there and were privileged to go in and look. This was another Orthodox church that was way out in an old town. In fact, the town is known as Old Orhe. And this was way up on the top of the hill, and the town was underneath of it, down the hill on the back side of this hill. On the front side of the hill was an absolute cliff down to a river. I'll show you that in a moment. But this was on the top of the hill. Down the hill a little bit of a ways was another structure. Here's the outside of that structure. It was a monastery built straight into the side of the cliff. It was truly amazing. And they would come around, no, can't really see it, can you? Where is that thing? That gets totally lost, doesn't it? So they would come around this corner here and go in the door. Fortunately, in modern times, they built a door on the back side. So we were able to walk down some nice steps. It was really easy, and I came out that door, looked around, and went back in. So yeah, it was not where I wanted to be. This whole cliff face was sedimentary from settlings that had shells all in the cliff face. You could see shells embedded all in here. And in fact, you can see there's little dark spots. That's where some of the shells have been taken out. And they would occasionally put little coins into those little cracks where the shells came out as offerings there. And so I need to explain a little bit about their money. I'm sure you've probably seen one of these before. They're getting rare nowadays as we do everything on our phones, but this is a dollar bill, in case you don't remember. And it's worth about a dollar. And so this is one lei. So you can see it's a little bit different. One lei is worth 1/20th of a dollar. So it's worth about a nickel, yes. This is worth 5 cents. And so they would take these coins that were parts of one of these, so only bits of a nickel, and they would put them in there. And that was some of their offerings that they would do. But the monks that lived inside of this monastery were pretty amazing, because this was their worship place, as you can see, carved out of the barren rock, straight out of the rock. They carved this place. This was the lectern. I'd like to see one of those up here next week, you know? No, not really. But they had many images that they worshiped too. You can see the images that they would often worship there. This was their sleeping quarters. I took this picture like this because the ceiling was only 4 feet tall. And so each one of those little holes in the rock was literally their bedroom, if you will, and they were just about big enough for a guy to slide into. So when you say your bed feels like a rock, trust me, these guys really did. They lived there, served in the monastery, and up on the church on the hill. They were committed in many ways to wrong things, but they were committed to the Lord and where the Lord would lead them. How about us? How committed are we? This is the Adventist Church headquarters in Moldova. This is the union office there. And it was where we had lunch most days for those of us who stayed in Chisinau. And this was, that's inside the union office there, just in the foyer as you go inside. This was where people looked for guidance as they came into the Adventist Church. Here I am outside of the Chisinau number 2 church. They numbered their churches in the capital city. I served my first week in Chisinau number 2. This is the pastor of the church there. He had been the union president, and now he was getting ready to retire, so he went and became pastor of the Chisinau number 2 church. Here I am preaching inside of that church with my translator, and we had about a dozen visitors each night there, regular visitors coming night by night to hear the Word of God. And we preached about the Sabbath, we preached the health message, we preached Jesus coming again. And so we wanted to make sure that they heard the Adventist message. But it isn't just those things, it's that Jesus loves us, yes? That He loves us enough to come again. And so this was the slide. You saw it a couple times on George's presentation. This was the first slide that they saw each night. It means Moldova for Christ. See, you're already speaking Romanian. It's good. Yes, Moldova for Christ. We wanted them to see Christ at the center of our work. Jesus was there at the center. This is an outline of the country of Moldova, and this is the colors of their flag. And so this was what they saw every night as they got started. On the back of the church, on the back of the church building, was another little room. And people would come in these doors at the far end over there, and they would come in here, and you'll notice the little projector and the screen there, because they would often have health presentations. They would have Bible studies there. You can see here things that would help them learn about health. Over here, books for them to learn about Jesus. Along this back wall that you can't see were bags and bags of various kinds of health foods and things that they could use in their daily lives to get their diet on track. Moldova is famous because it's kind of a breadbasket of the area. Tremendous soil, wasn't that true, George? Amazing soil there in their country. So they grew lots of stuff. And here we might measure farms in acres. You know, one of the main things that they grew was grapes. Lots and lots of grapes. And they didn't measure it typically as you went driving out across the countryside by acres. You'd measure them by miles. Just miles and miles of vineyards out there. Unfortunately, not all grapes were turned into Welch's. You can guess what the majority went for. Yes, in fact, the biggest winery in the world is in Moldova. I'm not sure that's what I would want my claim to fame to be, but that's what they did. And this was an opportunity right connected with the church building, in the church building, an opportunity for them to learn a better way of life. And so we would have people come. These are the young people that came after the meeting back to that room to talk about what the Lord had revealed to them that night. This young lady that's here was ready to be baptized. She was studying. She was about to be baptized. These two gentlemen, this is the first set of meetings that they've come to, as Adventist meetings. They'd never come to anything Adventist before. Here they were learning about Jesus. And as I understand it, I wasn't there the second week, but during the second week, they came forward to give their lives to the Lord. Here was the second church I went to. The first church, Kishnell number 2. Another guy came there. Maybe you've heard of him. He does this program called It Is Written. What's his name? John Bradshaw had a tough act to follow, but he did his best, you know. Not really. So I went to Kishnell number 9. This is Kishnell number 9. There was one of our missionaries that could only come for a single week. So when John was coming in, he went to Kishnell number 2. I went to Kishnell number 9 to pick up for the other fellow. This was a little bit further out, so that's why we couldn't have John go to that one. But this is a rented building. It kind of looks like a library or something, doesn't it? It's because it's a rented building. They are looking to build their own building. And some of what you did to help in Moldova is going to help them get a new building. And so that's part of what we did. We were instrumental with that. This is a group of the folks that were in Kishnell number 9. The guy with his hand on my shoulder there was my translator. And let me tell you a little bit about his story. He was so willing to help translate. He was so willing to come there every night, even though he was a really busy guy. He came every night because he had been here in America for a few months. And the church members of our Adventist church had loved him so much. He said, I just have to return some of that. And so he was willing to help me translate because people had blessed him who did not know him, and he was going to bless me even though he didn't know me. And so how we treat people right here in this building makes a huge difference. Makes a huge difference. This gentleman here is his father, and because of what he's been doing, his father came forward. And so he is also learning about Jesus. George talked a little bit about the food. I'm telling you, they knew how to lay it on. I got to the point where it was like, you know, I just can't eat anymore. I'd take 2 or 3 helpings of something, and the lady of the house would come rushing over, and she'd say, no, no, and she'd put 3 more on. Oh. So they really were very kind and loving folks. But they didn't all look like that. Sometimes they only looked like this because they didn't have a ton of money. But they did what they could, and they had plenty of food. They might not have much of a table, but they had plenty of food, and they loaded it up. This was actually at...
Serge's house.
Serge's house, but what's the name of the church again? I was only there one day. What was the name?
Loganesht,
yes. This was at Loganesht. Loganesht has a tremendous story because this man is the current pastor of that church. This man was the pastor of the church in 1982. What was happening in Moldova? Who was in control of Moldova in 1982? That's right. Moldova was part of the USSR. And there was a move to clamp down on the Loganesht church. Tremendous story, tremendous story. I want to be this man when I grow up. I can tell you, he's a tremendous fellow.
He was arrested for...
Yeah, that's where I'm going. That's where I'm going with this. I want to be that man when I grow up, because in 1982, the move against this church brought members from all around, and they all converged on Loganesht and occupied. We think it's some new thing to occupy, but no, they did it back in 1982. They occupied the church, and when the Soviets got there, they're like, and they kind of had second thoughts because they could see this was very important. And so They didn't like being put off on their plans, though, so they took all of the members, all of the people that came to occupy the church, they loaded them up on buses, they hauled them 10 kilometers out into the middle of nowhere and just dropped them off. Have a nice day. Yeah. Although there were two that they arrested. One was the treasurer of the church. The other was Vasily, the pastor of the church. They put him in prison where he stayed for 2 years and went blind. He gave up his sight for the Lord. It's just an amazing story what he was willing to do for his God. Amazing story. Here he was this night, and when we started singing that night, you could hear his voice singing with gusto the songs of his Lord and Savior. Amen. Wow, what a story of faithfulness this guy was. We can all do the same. We can do the same. We would often visit homes. This was another little family, and in Kishinev, in the middle of the city, it isn't like out in place where George was. We very rarely had children. This was pretty much the only two children. I think there were two more that came to Kishinev number 9, and this was two of them. They basically had no Sabbath school materials, no stuff to work with. So again, some of the monies that you helped with went to buy books and materials for these children so that they could know Jesus better. And so we visited these homes. Here's another home that we went to. And as George said, there's a real dichotomy. Part of them wanting to be European, part of them wanting to be Russian. And so there was this struggle that was going on. This young man right here, his parents are here. This young man right here was of the European bent. And so he was trying to go that way. So he was trying to pick up a lot of the culture of Europe of well, we've heard about God. We've heard about all that stuff. We don't really need that anymore. That's old, you know, that was for our parents and that kind of thing. So this young man is struggling, yes, a member of the Adventist church, but his thinking is being pulled away. We need to be praying for folks like this because this is a big struggle within the church just now. My guess is within a very short time, he will immigrate. That's one of the main problems with Moldova right now is brain drain. Folks leaving the country as soon as they have any skills, abilities, or ambition, they get out of there as soon as possible. And so it's a very difficult situation for our church, which has actually seen a decline, not because people are just forgetting the church, but because they're immigrating out of the country. And so a lot of the young professional people with ability are leaving, and it's leaving a real hole in the church. And so we have very few young people in Kishinev, and so we need help there to help others find Jesus. Here are the people that had come each night, had made a decision for Christ. I'm sorry, my camera was kind of nasty, didn't take great pictures, but this older gentleman here, tremendous story. You can read it on the blog. Anybody read the blog? Did you read the blog a little bit? All right, all two of you. Okay, good. So, threeangelsonline.org with the number 3, threeangelsonline.org. You can read this gentleman's story right here. He was a French teacher. That was how he made his living as a French teacher, but how he got there was really amazing. The girl next to him right here, you remember I told you about my translator? That's his girlfriend. He was so instrumental. Again, we, by loving him here, took that back and was loving others, being a blessing to others, and had talked his girlfriend into coming. She now was making a decision for Christ. Here she is getting her book. All of this was part of the total member involvement program. That's why we were there, because the General Conference put together this program called Total Member Involvement. and different organizations were given the responsibility of working with different countries. It is written, was requested to work with Moldova. That's how we came to be in Moldova as part of the TMI, the Total Member Involvement Program. Now's the time for that little video.
The General Conference is launching a new, visionary, bold initiative called Total Member Involvement. I believe with all my heart that Jesus is coming very soon.
Every church member can do something. That's what Total Member Involvement is all about.
The Lord has placed on my heart a huge burden, a burden to help each of us realize that we must be totally involved in God's last day message. And that has to do with everything from speaking the word to living the word, following Christ's example in everything, helping people physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually.
Thousands and thousands of lay people are actively involved in praying for their neighbors and giving Bible studies and distributing literature. But whatever we have done up until this point, it is not yet total member involvement.
One of the greatest challenges we face is the devil's attempt to neutralize our mission, endeavor, and focus because we don't have a relationship with the Lord.
I'm reminded of what Ellen White said in Desire of Ages, page 142. In order to develop a character like Christ, we must work as He worked. There's something about service, something about ministry, something about witnessing that brings revival to our own hearts. This is why I am so encouraged about total member involvement.
There are so many examples all over the world as to what God is doing through His members, through those who are really committed to Him. There in Chitungwiza in Harare, Zimbabwe, thousands of people involved in specific assignments in reaching people with the precious message, whether they were visiting, whether they were helping out in a health expo, whether they were doing Bible studies, whether they were just welcoming people, whatever it was, they were involved.
In Zimbabwe itself, there were over 918 meetings going on at the same time all across that great country. And in the end, 30,000 people were baptized.
A beautiful example in San Antonio, Texas. Literally thousands of people involved in reaching out to the community of San Antonio.
Over 700 people were baptized.
One of the things that really amazed me about San Antonio and that Your Best Pathway to Health was that total involvement, 1,500 people involved, ministering to the needs of over 6,100 individuals that came. Many of them stayed all night in line. And as I watched what God did, it was amazing.
In Harare, Zimbabwe, over 30,000 people were affected through this special outreach, which God says is the right arm of the gospel. One can praise the Lord and say, wow, that's great, it happened over there, but what am I going to do in my little place?
What about the difficult parts of the world? What about postmodern culture? I know this, some places are more difficult than others, but if you don't believe that you can win people for Christ in that setting, you won't win anybody.
I want to tell you, the Lord has a job for all of us, and God is going to bless you regardless of how small the operation or how large.
Doing something gives God an avenue to bless.
The real factor is your commitment to the Lord and to following Christ's method alone.
How can I, as a church member, become involved in total member involvement? The first thing that I think is significantly important is to get on your knees and begin to pray and say, Lord, I am consecrating myself to You. I'm giving myself to You. What do You want me to do? Whatever it is, whether it's to be an intercessor in prayer and concentrate on a prayer ministry, whether it is actively involved in health ministry, whether it's literature ministry, whether it's children's ministry, whether it's Bible study ministry or preaching.
I just feel an overwhelming burden that all of us need to be involved. Everyone has a job that the Lord can provide. Everyone can be a missionary for Jesus. No matter whether you're in a sophisticated society or in a simple setting, God can use each of us.
Jesus has given us a great commission to go and preach and teach and baptize. The commission is to you personally. It's to me, no matter who you are.
Why not get on your knees and say, Jesus, I want to be an active witness for you. I want to be involved, totally, completely involved with the entire church in total member involvement.
Amen. While he's going back to the presentation, I would like for you to pull out your paper that you got today. The little quote from Ellen White there. Sometimes Ellen White quotes where they came from are really hard to remember, you know? It came from this page and that paragraph and all of that. This one's really easy. Look at the bottom. AA, it's the first letter of the alphabet, right? AA111.1. It doesn't get any easier than that. It's all the first part. All right? So you'll know where to find this. It's from Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles, page 111 and paragraph 1. Long has God waited for what? Spirit of service. Who's waiting, by the way? Are we waiting for God? No, He's waiting for us. He's waiting for us. Long has God waited for the spirit of service, not the spirit of doctrine. Doctrine is good. We have to have the correct doctrine. We preached the doctrine in Moldova. No question about that. I'm not taking that away at all. But what we're missing is service. Long has God waited for the spirit of service to take possession of who? Whole church, so that a few. Pastors, right? Missionaries like George, right? Is that what it says? No, everyone. So that everyone will be working for Him. Oh, but Pastor, I don't know much about working for the Lord. I don't have very much I can do for God. That's okay, because what does it say? According to what? His ability. God's not asking you to go out and preach to 1,000 people. That's not what He's asking. If all you can do is pick up the phone because you can't even get out of your house, that's all right. God can use you. According to your ability, everyone doing what they can, not what they can't. When the members of the Church of God do their appointed work in the needy fields, where are the needy fields? At home and abroad. George went abroad. Does that mean all of us have to? No. It means that we can do God's work right here at home, yes? With the spirit of service. Because by doing so, we're in fulfillment of the gospel commission. And what will be the result? The whole world will soon be warned, and the Lord Jesus will return. Jesus will come again. We are Adventist, aren't we? Amen. Adventist, yes? Amen. Come on now, aren't we Adventist? Yes. That means we're looking for the advent of Jesus, aren't we? Yes. It's up to you and I to hasten that coming, isn't it? Yes. How do we do it? She's telling us right here how to do it. The Lord Jesus will return to the earth with power and great glory. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. Not might be preached, could be preached, but it shall be preached. Shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto the nations. And once that's done, what will happen? The end will come. Go therefore, we read today. Go therefore and make disciples. That's what we're here to do. We're not just talking about dip them and drop them. Right? We want to make disciples. We want them to become followers of Jesus. That's what the scripture says, not Ron. The scriptures say make disciples. We want to make disciples of what? All nations. So not just Moldova and places way out there, but it's incumbent upon us, the church members here, to make it happen in the USA, isn't it? Of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them. Are we supposed to teach them what to observe? Absolutely, that is what we are supposed to do. Teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you. And we have a great promise, don't we? I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do right here in Plymouth-Sorrento? Everyone can do something to hasten the coming of Jesus, yes? What can we do? Number one. Oh, I want to read this first. We have no time to lose. Every moment is golden and altogether too precious to be devoted merely to self-serving. We saw folks over there with big tables with lots of food and others with little tables with lots of food. They did what they could. They gave what they could. Sometimes I wonder if I'm too busy worrying about my house and my cars and all this kind of stuff. I'm too busy serving self to serve Jesus. You know what I mean? Because we just have too much stuff. I wonder if the Lord might take that away from us and remove it someday. Hmm? What can we do? Number one, pray. Pray, 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 brothers and sisters. Pray for the gospel advancement, both in Moldova and right here at home, yes? Number two, support Adventist World Radio, Hope TV. It is written, huh? All of those things, yes? Number three, support and pray for Adventist mission. There's lots of that kind of thing going on. When we saw the mission story this morning that we were presented with, I've been in that hospital more times than I want to say sometimes. Because I ate some things there occasionally that didn't agree with me and ended up there. So I know about that Adventist hospital in Seoul because I spent years in Seoul City living on that hospital compound. God's work is going forward because of missions. And so we want to pray for them, support them. We want to participate in local and institutional health outreach events. We do health things right here, things for teaching people how to live a healthier life. Number five, we can get involved in Sabbath school care groups just down here in the other building. And what you're reading about in the Southern Tidings right now was the result of a Sabbath school project. The outreach to the police here, the thank you dinner to the police that we did right here, was a Sabbath school mission project, if you will. And so we need to get involved in all of these kinds of things. Number six, volunteer with local community service events. How can we help with that? Number seven, organize health seminars, small groups, Bible studies. Terry, do we have anybody who needs Bible studies? Absolutely. Could we have everyone who's sitting here have a Bible study and still have some left over? Uh-huh. If you want, we have opportunities for you to do exactly this kind of work right here, right now, in this place. Number eight, help with children's, youth, Pathfinder, community service projects. We just committed this morning to helping one of our newest little members, well, at least dedicated members there, to come to know Jesus. How are we going to make that happen if you don't get to be part of that work? All of us can be part of this. Number nine, volunteer with evangelistic events. We have things coming up that I'll talk about in a moment that you can be a part of. Number 10, and this is why it's discipling and not just getting people wet. We need to befriend new members and nurture them. Brothers and sisters, when they're baptized, they're only here as a beginning. Now we need to help them understand what it is to be a member. To come close to them, draw near to them, help them to know what it is to serve Jesus and be a disciple. And so we can do those kinds of things. What can we do? Right here, I've given you 10 things. When do we get started? Right now. Plymouth-Sorrento Seventh-day Adventist Church evangelistic series comes up at the end of next month. We can make a difference. We can make things happen. You can be talking to your neighbors. You can be doing Bible studies right now. You can be telling them that we have a series coming up right in this place next month. You can be a part of this. Total member involvement. Isn't this what you want to see? Right there? You want to see Jesus come. Why should we wait until little Brianna grows up and has to deal with even bigger problems? Why don't we do the work now and take her home before she ever has to worry about the problems of this world?
Amen.
Right? Let's make this happen. That's our commission. That's who we are. Acts of the Apostles, page 111, paragraph 1. We need to be God's hands and feet if we want to see this happen in our lifetime. Amen. Is that what you want? Are you Adventist?
Amen.
Come on now. Are you Adventist?
Amen.
Amen. This is where we are. Total member involvement. The people in Moldova, this is their flag. They were very happy for what you have done. And they sent home with me a little plaque that we're giving to the church. And so this will be a reminder that we can be a part of what God is doing in His world today. We have a place. We have a part. God is working through you already. And this is just a little reminder. You can see all the grapes and the fruit and the things. Even have a little ladybug there showing what God can do. And so that is for us here at this church. Will you be a part of what God is doing? That's the question.